Niccolo Machiavelli was one of the most foremost man of letters in the late Renaissance. He is remembered as the author of the Primer for Princes, generally translated as The Prince in English. His name is associated with manipulation and the idea that it is better to be evil than good to maintain political power. However, Machiavelli's more important treatise was his historico-political reflection on philosophy, politics, and history, a commentary over the histories by the Roman historian Livy, interwoven with additional ancient historical examples to ground his theory of political governance and development, the Discourses on Livy. Machiavelli asserts there are only two types of governments that exist, republics and monarchies, or anything that is simply not a republic. What is a republic then? A republic, according to Machiavelli, is the public thing. But what is the public thing? Taking in considerations from all sectors of social life, religion, economics, class, and so forth, a republic integrates every aspect of human life and society in its political order. Republics, in Machiavelli's mind, do not need to be necessarily democratic in the sense that all men have the right to vote. Nay, a republic is a republic as long as the form of government takes into consideration for political decision-making all the sectors of political and social life. As mentioned, this includes religion as much as it does economics, class as much as it does all the various peoples that compose a polity. It includes class, big business, small business, craftsmen, workers, bankers, etc. Everyone must be included in the rubric of the Republic. Rome serves as Machiavelli's historical backdrop to ground his vision in history. The Roman Republic was superior to the Empire and did not have one man, one vote. But what developed over the course of the Republic's rise and eventual fall was that the interests of the disenfranchised class of plebeians was represented by political movements in the Roman Senate. Pro-plebeian tribunes, like the Gracchus brothers, ensured that Rome was a republic, even if the plebeians didn't have the right to vote. Again, we see Machiavelli's notion of a republic as taking into consideration and representing the interests of all parties in society, irrespective if those individuals have the right to vote. Thus, a republic is not synonymous with democracy. Though a democracy can be a republic, yet a democracy can also not be a republic if a democratic majority, and only that majority, is what influences political decision-making. Likewise, the complex network of what we would call today special interest groups advocating on behalf of their constituents, farmers, fishermen, craftsmen, landowners, etc., is, by definition, the embodiment of a republic. But how does this unique and exceptional polity called a republic come into existence? This is what Machiavelli is principally concerned with analyzing in the Discourses on Livy, and his answer is surprising and shocking to most. Yet when we peel back the veil to understand it, it is actually perhaps commonsensical. Conflict is what brings about the formation of republican government. Machiavelli sees conflict as essential for the development of the most practical and most efficient form of government in human life, which of course is a republic. Here we see Machiavelli as a sort of ruthless pragmatist rather than a naive idealist. Conflict is the basis of all politics. And conflict, contrary to what we get told today as something negative, is in fact something good. Yet, his ruthless pragmatism does have an idealistic slant to it. He does not slouch into pessimism, but calls for activism. Those who have no power, i.e. no representation or interest groups, should become active and fight against the representatives and interest groups that keep them suppressed. Through this purely political dialectic, which is not the Marxist class dialectic, conflict ensures greater equality and liberty, greater work for the common good, and greater representation of interests, though not always proportional to the population size. In a word, Machiavelli's republican government is Catholic, but it is Catholic without Christianity. Reflecting upon religion, which has its own interests in a republic and does not get closed out by the separation of church and state, Machiavelli favors a sort of militant and activist religion rather than a humble, merciful, and intellectual contemplative religion. Machiavelli's esoteric criticism of Christianity, though his book was published, ironically, with papal approval, was that it too often favored the meek and intellectual rather than the strong and engaged. But Machiavelli doesn't write peons to classical paganism either, since the ancient pagan cults never had a unified vision of man, and had, indeed, a very, very bleak anthropology compared to the humanism of Christianity, or the same corporate, communal understanding of society and the world as Catholicism developed, which is what Machiavelli principally inherits and secularizes in his political theology. Machiavelli's religion was part pagan, favoring the strong and the warlike, and part Catholic, corporate, social, and public. The main task of religion, in Machiavelli's eyes, was to maintain an engaged and active citizenry, public order, and to confront wicked and domineering men wherever they prop up. In other words, religion ought to make strong men willing to sacrifice for the community rather than make men weak and wanting to seek peace instead of conflict. Because again, conflict is what drives the development and progress of all republican societies, and conflict is what advances liberty and equality. Religion has an integral role to play in creating, reorienting, and advancing man's roots. In commentating over Rome's renewal after the sack of the city by the Gauls in 390 BC, their rejection of religion led them down a path of decadence and injustice. Their renewal of religion led them to a renewal of virtue and justice in public life. In fact, the vitality of religion in society, Machiavelli says, is a good indicator of where a society is in its life cycle and whether it will progress towards greater political participation and republican government or slouch into tyranny and the rule of a few. It is here that one must understand Machiavelli's bleak understanding of the world as a sort of non-Christian Augustinianism, where man drowns in sin and his only hope of salvation is to confront, rather than humbly accept, the libido dominandi of other men. Conflict calls men to greatness, and in that greatness, the realities and the movement to greater liberty, equality, and order is found. And it is this confrontational activism that is necessary for the progress of the body politic and republican politics to achieve the most pragmatic and orderly form of government possible that mixes greater liberty in the sense of represented interests with order, that which allows people to live their lives without fear of violence or disorder in their neighborhoods. If one fails to confront the libido dominandi, then there is no republican advancement. The patrician class, the landowning economic interests, the priestly class, etc., would reign supreme. Whoever is the dominant force would simply dominate everyone else and therefore become what Machiavelli calls a monarchy, or what other political theorists have sometimes called an oligarchy or tyranny. But why would this become a problem? Stagnation breeds complacency and, in of itself, leads to decadence. Thus, even a powerful class and group of people who have long held power and not felt the threat of losing power themselves invariably grow weak and unable to confront the problems of society when they beset them. Had Machiavelli grown past Livy to comment on the fall of the Roman Empire, he would have likely commented on the nature of imperial complacency and the decadence of the ruling class that had no threats of conflict from the underclass. Threats to the ruling class and threats to the ruling interests keep the leaders of society on their toes, keeps them sharp, keeps them ready to face greater threats, such as external ones as well as internal ones, when they emerge. Threats are necessary for a republic to continue progressing forward. The lack of threats, the lack of conflict, breeds complacency, decadence, and decline. Likewise, the activism of all sectors of political life lead to that conflict which leads to people, new representative interest groups, pursuing their interests, and out of conflict, the eventual compromises that bring greater liberty and equality to everyone in society. Machiavelli sees the starting point of political government not of unity or harmony, but of disorder and totalizing control of one group over others, which eventually progresses into greater inclusion through conflict. Through conflict, this disorder yields to order, and totalizing control breaks down into representative interest groups, all of which have a place at the political table. Rather than coming together, as many politicians and movements preach today, Machiavelli asserts pursuing your own interests, which counterintuitively leads to a better coming together than coming together does. There is a certain irony we find in Machiavelli's political outlook. It is through conflict that people come to the coming together table to hash out their problems in compromise. Not coming together to endlessly talk and talk and talk when we don't actually have conflict. Thus, the golden age of the Roman Republic, as he says, was born through the plebeian-patrician conflict. The conflict of the orders, as it is sometimes called, was two centuries of conflict between the senatorial and land-owning patrician class, which dominated all the interests and powers of the Roman state, and the plebeians, an assortment of low-skilled to high-skilled, noble and non-noble soldiers, tenant workers, and small-scale landowners who held no power. Out of this conflict between the large landowning aristocratic class and everyone else, the greatness of the Roman Republic was born. As such, only the interests of the patricians was initially represented, and Rome was not truly a republic. But when the interests of the plebeians and other groups in Roman society came into political provenance through the conflict of the orders, the Roman Republic was born. The Republic then, as Machiavelli states, only came into being through this conflict, which absorbed the interests and the patriotism of the plebeians and created a stronger, more vibrant republic. Therefore, conflict is necessary rather than unnecessary for political liberty. Machiavelli is a proto-Hegelian and proto-Schmidtian. Or, more properly, Hegel and Schmidt were influenced by Machiavelli. Man is not born free, as Rousseau and Marx asserted, but some men were born free, and most other men were not. Men who were not born free become free through conflict and acquisition of security. Two driving forces that run through the founding of cities and their ascent to prominence and republican government. Whereas Rousseau and Marx saw man as becoming enslaved through conflict, only when the exhaustion of conflict dissipates to nothing do all return to their original freedom in the historicism of Rousseau and Marx, conflict, in Machiavelli's eyes, is essential to bringing about the best order, the most practical order, the most stable order, the greatest order of liberty. Conflict is essential to bringing out a republic where all interests and sectors of life are represented, whether by one man or 100 men, whether by one man, one vote, or a duly appointed lobbyist on behalf of the constituents he represents. Machiavelli also gives us consideration in the present life that we live in the 21st century. If conflict is necessary for the enlargement of liberty and the bringing about of the best and most practical political order, and if man is essentially a domineering animal, how are we to address the problem and malaise of contemporary liberalism? Liberalism as a philosophy and political theory asserts the very opposite of what Machiavelli sees through the development of Roman history and the history of his own time in late Renaissance Italy. Liberalism shuns conflict and seeks a world of non-harm, i.e., non-conflict. Liberalism preaches compromise and tolerance rather than conflict and aggressively pursuing self-interest. Liberalism preaches the common good, but does not know how to make the common good a reality. Machiavelli asserts the common good can only come about by the conflict of competitive interest groups, inadvertently bringing about greater wealth, greater representation, and greater cooperation by each pursuing his own end, and in the conflict that comes about from each pursuing their own end, leading to that cooperation and true compromise that brings the best result to everyone living in society. Order and unity do not come from submission, but from conflict. Republican governance, the government form that best represents all interests and sectors of political life, only comes about from conflict. And this is perhaps why, as Machiavelli sees it, republican governments are the most militaristic and militant, like the Roman Republic, like, after Machiavelli, the Dutch Republic, the American Republic, and the French Republic. Moreover, the greatness of the Romans was because of their willingness to seek conflict and confront their enemies, both domestically and externally. The collapse of the Romans, if we extend Machiavelli's commentary out further, was because of their decadence and weakness. Their attempt to rely on foreign mercenaries and bribery to deal with their crises rather than to confront them head-on is what led to the downfall of the Romans and the collapse of the Roman Republic. The end of virtue and the end of conflict is what leads to imperium and empire. If we are to have a republican government, a government with the greatest amount of liberty and equality, Machiavelli asserts throughout the Discourses on Livy that greater and greater conflict is necessary, not a coming together in peaceful compromise, but a compromise that emerges from the intensity of conflict. And if we, in the 21st century, are stuck in the malaise of decadence, then Machiavelli would assert, as he does in the Discourses on Livy, that we should welcome a great social conflict, both domestic and international, to bring about greater republican government, greater democracy, greater liberty, and greater equality. Yet when we think about it from Machiavelli's perspective, we all know that he's right. The greatest advancements in liberty and equality throughout human history have always come from conflict.